not only that, he gives us the other pieces. Sometimes I can't say my things.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Just talking back there, and then pretty soon I'm supposed to be up front. Well, happy Mother's Day to all of you mothers.
Thank you.
Have a blessed day and enjoyable time to whatever you may be doing today. We have several things that we're going to do in the service, which are additions to the normal service, so you look forward to those things. In the sermon today, I'm going to zero in on 1 Peter 3, verse 15. That's that verse which says, always be prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that you have. And, you know, I always kick myself. A lot of times I say, man, there was an opportunity for me to make a witness, and I didn't say anything, you know? And I'm sure you're the same way. You know, after the fact, you say, I should have said something. And God provides us all kinds of opportunities, which, you know, we don't always take. So this is what that's going to be about, making a witness of the faith, about the hope that you have as a Christian. And that's the difference that separates us from other people who have no hope. You know, even in dire circumstances, we have hope because we have a God who's in charge, and we know that we can turn to Him, and He's going to see us through. Are there any prayer requests this morning? I've got one from our family. Our sister-in-law, Amy, is going to have back surgery this week, so we want to think about her.
I talked to Nancy Hayes yesterday. Frank came through his surgery, his back surgery, so prayers for ease of pain for Frank.
That's her husband?
That's her husband.
Okay.
And also prayers for Nancy during this time period.
And it's New Orleans. It's New Orleans.
New Orleans.
Yeah.
New Orleans.
Or they all say New Orleans.
New Orleans.
So you're not from there, I can tell.
Oops.
That was God telling you.
Oh, he's talking to you again.
I'm getting too close this one way or another. I don't know what it is. Yes, Christy. Ethan and Luke? Okay, very good. Okay, let's begin with the rite of the blessing of the banners, and I guess these are the banners that are hanging here.
Yes.
That,
and the one up front, yes.
And one up here, yes, okay. Please rise. Let us make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Beloved in the Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty, the Lord is robed. He has put on strength as his belt. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. It is therefore fitting that we implore the Lord's blessing as we clothe the altar of his sanctuary, from which he strengthens and preserves us in the true faith. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord God Almighty, you instructed Moses, your servant, to make hangings and fine linens for use in your tabernacle. We implore you to sanctify these worship matters for the adornment of your church, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And the Lord Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless these worship banners.
Amen. Amen.
Keep us safe.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord, from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised.
He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the ash heap, to make them sit with princes of his people.
He gives a barren woman a home, making her joyous mother of children. Praise the Lord.
The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens.
My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior.
Let us confess our sins to God our Father.
Strengthen us, Lord, and grant us your forgiveness. We confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. Repent of our many sins, those known to us and those unknown as well. Create in us clean hearts, gracious Lord, and put new and right spirits within us, that we may know the fullness of your love and be at peace with all people.
By God's grace, you have been known and loved by him from before the time you were born. Through the suffering, death, and resurrection of his Son, Jesus Christ, he has brought about the forgiveness of all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord, out of his glorious riches, strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith.
Amen. Amen.
Through Jesus Christ, our risen Savior and Lord, who lives eternally with the Father and the Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
From Acts 17, verses 16 through 31. While Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him as he saw that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him, and some said, "What does this babbler wish to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities, because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection. And they took hold of him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? For you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." Now all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing telling of hearing something new. So Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription: to the unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, this is I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God in the hope that they might feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your poets have said, for we indeed are indeed his offspring. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, and an image formed by the art and imagination of man. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson for today is from 1 Peter 3, verses 13 through 22. Now who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer from righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. But in your hearts regard Christ the Lord as holy. Always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey. When God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through the water, baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you. Not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers, having been subjected to him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world will see me no more. But you will see me, because I live, you also will live. In that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
This morning we have the treat of having a woman's course, so you may be seated to listen to that. took his young daughter on a cruise to get away after his wife and his daughter's mother had died. Standing on the deck of the ship one day, the little girl asked an important question. She said, "Daddy, does God love us as much as Mommy did?" At first, the father didn't know what to say, but he knew that he couldn't simply sidestep that question. So pointing out across the water to the most distant horizon, he said, "Honey, God's love reaches further than we can see in that direction." Then he pointed out the other way, and he said, "And God's love reaches further than you can see in that direction." And then he pointed up, and he says, "God's love is higher than the sky." And finally, he pointed down to the water, and he said, "God's love is deeper than the ocean." It was then that the child said it as only a child can express a beautiful witness. She said, "Then just think, Daddy, we're right in the middle of all of it." And so we are. We're never alone now that Christ is alive and has overcome the power of sin and conquered the power of death. That's the good news that we hear again today. That's the good news that we as the people of Christ are called upon to hand on to others. The Apostle Peter issues this call in the epistle lesson for today. He says, "Always be prepared to make a defense or to give an answer to anyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that you have. Yet do it with gentleness and respect." These words were first spoken to people who were scattered out throughout Asia Minor near the end of the first century. Even though they had just been recent converts to the Christian faith, these new Christians were already facing the reality that they would suffer persecution because of their confession of the gospel. Some were imprisoned. Some were driven out of their homes. Some lost their jobs. Still others paid for their confession of faith with their own lives. But the time of persecution of those who give witness to the faith in Jesus wasn't just limited to way back then, to that first century. For persecution and martyrdom of Christians still goes on in our time and in our world. It's reported that during the 20th century, that is during the 1900s, over 40 million Christians died as a result of the witness to their faith. If you think about that, that means that throughout that last century, every day, on an average, 1,100 Christians gave their lives for the sake of the gospel. And it continues still today. For in some 50 countries around the world, there's still active persecution of Christians. Those facts give us who live in the United States a truer picture of what it means to be a Christian in other parts of the world. And they help us to appreciate what other Christians are up against when they give a reason for the hope that is in them. Now, our circumstances, our individual circumstances, are strikingly different. We don't have active, cruel opposition, but yet we are seeing that develop even now in this country. But hatred against Christ and his church can still take more subtle forms. Some among us might live in a household where others in the family don't believe the Christian faith, don't believe in the joy and the hope that we have. Some of us work in places where there's only a few Christians and the others don't care. And they make openly, they make jokes and fun about Christians, putting living the faith to work in today's college campuses, or living the Christian-like, Christ-like life, if you're a teenager today, doesn't win popularity contests. But no matter what the situation, the call to witness comes to all of us who are in Christ. So let's first of all be clear about the content of our witness. For I continually find that there's so much uncertainty about this. The biblical meaning of witness is telling the good news of Jesus Christ, crucified and risen for us. Witness means sharing the gospel that points to God the Father, who through grace sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be your Savior. Witness is not just general conversation about religious things. It's not talking about our denomination. It's not talking about our church, our pastor, our tradition, or even our accomplishments. Witness always points to Christ, crucified and risen, to reclaim the world from sin and death. Secondly, by telling us always to be prepared to make a defense or to give an answer to anyone, Peter is not telling us to strong-arm people with the gospel. No one benefits from a pushy approach in this matter, which often means becoming a religious pest instead of a Christian witness. It never honors God to treat others as a potential religious conquest. Witnessing isn't for our sake. Witnessing is for the sake of others. And that's why Peter adds, yet do it with gentleness and respect. For no doubt Peter had learned from his own personal experience that harsh words spoken, even if they are true, turn people off. And so he says, do it with gentleness and respect for the other person, not forcing the person to make a decision for Christ right then and there. Gentleness and respect have to do with patient waiting on God's time. People must be ready to hear. And as some of us know, sometimes that takes a long time. And that leads to the third insight into witness, which this text offers. It's made by the important phrase used in verse 16. He says, he talks about your good behavior. Behavior, of course, has to do with deeds and actions. How can we expect the world to pay attention to our witness if we say one thing and then do another? Christian witness has to go hand in hand with Christ-like living. History tells us that Alexander the Great was accustomed to holding court on the battlefield and trying offenders right there on the spot. On one occasion, there was a young man who was brought before him who was charged with desertion. Alexander asked the soldier, "Young man, what is your name?" "Alexander," the accused young man replied. Alexander came right down to him, stood face to face with the man. He put his hands on his shoulders and he shook him. And he said, "Either change your name or change your conduct." We as Christians bear a great name too. A great name that we have to live up to. Either we are imitators of and witnesses to our risen Lord Jesus Christ, or we don't deserve to bear his name. We must either change our name or change our conduct. The purpose of good works is to demonstrate the gospel in concrete actions. When your faith becomes noticeable by what you do and how you act. And others will begin to ask, what's in your heart? Because they will see that you live in a different way. And that's the best setting to make a witness. But there's no one formula that fits every time and every place and every situation. Peter doesn't lay down a pat formula or a set presentation that's to be memorized or spoken in some way by every Christian. He knew that we are different as people. He knew that different Christians will offer their testimony to the Lord Jesus in different ways. We do a great deal of witnessing to each other every time we gather together as a congregation for worship. So many of our hymns have words that we address to each other, filled with encouragement and admonition. The scripture lessons we read, the prayers that we pray, the creed that we speak together, all are a witness to the faith that we share. And each time we come to communion, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. However, the main opportunities for our witness are outside the walls of this church building. Sometimes it's when our spirits are low and times are bad. But even in such bad moments, we need to meditate on the Word of God, for the Scriptures are written to teach us, so that through endurance and the encouragement of Scripture, we might have hope. Or, as the psalmist says it so well, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. And sometimes our witness comes amidst times when our spirits are filled with joy and happiness. A marriage, a birth of a child, a recovery from illness, an anniversary, a birthday, an advancement, things that make us glad. Such times and occasions are opportune moments for us to give praise to God, to exalt Christ, give him the glory. An overflow of blessing should prompt us to share the hope that we have in our hearts. May we be prepared and ready to do just that. I conclude with a true story, a witness from the autobiography of the British actor Alec Guinness. For some years, Alec had been an agnostic, where he neither had faith nor doubted the existence of God, but he didn't claim that faith. He was turned off by religion. He believed that his life was but a matter of chance and that everything was up to him. But then something happened one day which changed all of that. Alec was playing the lead role in a film that featured him as a Catholic priest. And the film was being filmed on location in a small French village. One night after filming all day, he still had his priestly cassock on as he took a walk through the park. Dark though it was, he heard a child's voice cry out, in French, of course, and the child was saying, "My father, my father." Then the child came up to him, he grabbed his hand, and he walked with him, chattering happily as they walked along. Well, Guinness didn't know what to do. He didn't even dare to say anything, afraid that he might do something to shatter the boy's illusion that he was a real priest. He kept absolutely quiet. But when they got to the village square, suddenly the boy let go of his hand and walked off by himself. Guinness said that he stopped there for a moment in the village square, and he began to think. That boy trusted him because he wore the garb of something that represented trust to that child. believe that Dennis was a Catholic father. And so he trusted his life in his hands in the dark of night. And that trust clearly made him not afraid. Surely, Dennis thought, there must be a greater father in whom I can put my trust so that I can live with that boy's confidence and free spirit. And from that little incident, Dennis learned to see himself not so different than that child, someone who needed a father to lean on for courage and for strength. From that little incident, he eventually became a man who learned to trust his life, put his trust in life, into the hands of the God and Father of us all, whose Easter deed through his Son has made all of the difference in the world. Who knows what door may open, perhaps mysteriously and wondrously, for the light of Easter to shine out through your deeds and then through your words of faith. So always be ready. Amen.
Amen.
And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, may that peace of God be with you now and keep you always in one true faith. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, we're going to have a reading of the Shepherd's Psalm for Mother's Day.
Says that the Lord is my shepherd. While the picture of the shepherd was so common and quite familiar to those who lived in biblical times, I'm not so sure that it's a picture that speaks to you and to me in our modern society. I don't think I've ever seen a real shepherd personally, perhaps a few sheep, but that's about it, which got me wondering whether there might not be another image we might use to depict the Lord and his constant care of us, as the Good Shepherd picture was intended to do. Since it's Mother's Day, I wonder if we could apply our experiences of a mother to the Good Shepherd Psalm to appreciate all the more the constant concern of our loving Lord for us who are his children. I shall not want, it says, and mothers are persons who see to our every need as best they can. They made us lie down in warm beds every evening and brought us those extra glasses of still waters when we called annoyingly for them in the night. They made us feel good again when we were feeling bad, restoring our souls, and it was probably from Mother that we first learned about the paths of righteousness, the difference between right and wrong, and what is proper way to go. From them, we first learned to call on the name of the Lord in simple prayers and to conduct our activities for his name's sake. I don't know what it's like for a sheep to walk through a dark valley full of shadows, but I do remember what it's like to be a child afraid of the dark, and what it's like to find yourself suddenly lost in spite of those dark, strange valleys and fears. I always knew that my mom was with me, and I would fear no evil.
Your rod and your staff, shepherd's equipment, might have to be replaced with something like pots and pans, mother's equipment, to prepare a table before which was always so comforting, fulfilling, welcoming, and loving. Rod and staff sometimes took the form of a handkerchief when needed, or a band-aid, or maybe a nice, clean towel to wipe dry after a sudsy bath. They comfort me. And so do the example, the care, the concern, the goodness and love, if you will, that have followed me all the days of my life. God couldn't be everywhere, so he invented mothers. The saying goes, and that's quite right, of course. God could be everywhere, but he invented mothers anyway to be his helpers. Just as he was always provided shepherds for the sheep and then said, "If you want to know what I am like, then look at them. I no longer dwell in the house of my parents. Life is like that. And now as parents ourselves, we sometimes look at one another rather hopelessly and say, we just can't do everything and be everywhere for our children. But the Lord can. That is precisely the message of the Easter season. Surely I am with you always. And when you know that he is, for we have seen him with us, from the cradle to the grave and beyond forever. So, if sheep and shepherds still don't quite provide the picture we need in order to comprehend our Lord's loving care and concern for us, then why not think of a mother and all that she means to us and for us on this Mother's Day?"
We rise to confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God,
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended to heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in the one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and to die like the Lord to come. Amen.
Lord of time and eternity, we remember your acts of kindness to your people through the ages. We bless you for the unspeakable love shown to us in the incarnation of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who was born of the Virgin Mary. As your Holy Spirit works in us, we magnify you and rejoice in our salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the world in which we live, that world to which our Lord was willing to come as an infant. On this day, we pray for all mothers, grandmothers, great-grandmothers, and all those who nurture children. Bless them with the ability to guide the children entrusted to their care with compassion and love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray that we would be ready servants, eager to fulfill your word, your will for our lives as we live in the communities that you have placed us. Give us a full appreciation for the gift that each one is in the circles of our acquaintance. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those with special needs and concerns these days, remembering especially the sick, the shut-in, and the hospitalized, and other situations which were named earlier this morning. We pray for Amy, for Frank and Nancy, for Carol, for Claire, for Brian and his fiancee, for Shelby, for Ethan and Luke. From your treasury of grace, meet the needs of all who call to you, granting them whatever is best for their lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
of all time, including Mary, whose sacrifice and dedication is celebrated on this day. Inspire us by her witness as we seek to serve you constantly all of our days. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting you in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Praise and thank you for saving us through the waters of baptism and giving us a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Through this meal, empower us to love you and to share the truth of hope that we have in you through the resurrection of Jesus with those in our homes, workplaces, and throughout our community. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter, and John, and with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we long magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Suffered once for our sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to you, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the saints in prison and who have gone into heaven, and is at your right hand with angels, authorities, and powers, having been subjected to him. As we come together at Jesus' table, we prepare to celebrate the gift he gives us, the full forgiveness of our sins, as we eat and drink his body and blood that come to us in bread and wine. Through this meal, empower us by your Spirit to love you by keeping your commands through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which has been shed for you, so that you might have the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Precious blood of Jesus Christ.
strengthen us as your offspring, and lead us to love others. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and rules with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
In the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, our brother and Savior, and the love of God the Father, and the blessed fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with you all.
Amen. Amen.
What time is your game night?
Oh, I'm sorry, 4 o'clock.
4 o'clock. We want people to show up on time or probably proper time. Otherwise, you'd be here by yourself.
Solid tip.
Oh.
I would just like to thank the Women's Chorus for sharing their gift today. It takes a lot to get up front, and I really appreciate their willingness, and I look forward to having some more of you join us every Monday night at 6 p.m.
Thank you for being a great
Yes.
And thank you.
don't have anything to say.
I actually have one small thing.
No, you do have something to say.
There's a sign-up sheet in the hall, on the hall table right there. It'll be there for the next 2 weeks. If anyone has served in the military that has no longer with us and they want to be remembered on Memorial Weekend, please write, fill it out. And they'll be remembered in the bulletin the last Sunday of this month.
And no more. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You have a question.